the main problems of malaria, you know, control. You know, there are three words. Control, elimination, eradication. There are three key words, you know, in fight against malaria. Now, it's what we do. I'm not mentioning control now because the control is mainly focusing on picking the malaria and giving appropriate drugs.
Okay.
Now, you've seen, which is quite worrisome. I was trained in the era of chloroquine.
Okay.
As a mode of treatment of
malaria. Yes.
One of the most wonderful drugs for malaria, you know, ever discovered. So now, gradually, we start seeing resistance to chloroquine. What is causing this resistance? Now, you're supposed to use drug for a certain period. People just take it when they feel well the first day, they abandon the drug. So at every point they abandon the drug, the parasite itself, you know, undergo some changes to create resistance because it's a living being.
It's like
it mutates. You know, it's a living thing, and then has to actually, you know, adapt to get well. Now, and then we've also seen the rise of what I would call television and radio adverts pushing for one particular drug or the other, you know, to treat malaria.
Okay.
Somebody said that, you know, this is a drug. Once you, you know. Now, by the time you get to the
that
third
itself
day,
a bad thing? Is it a bad thing?
I don't think it's properly done.
Okay.
Yeah, because most times you hear that you take artesunate, ACT, and
you,
all of
you
that.
They give you a lot of options.
No,
yeah.
And, and the truth is that we have limited molecule to play with. We've lost it with chloroquine. We have to reserve quinine for very terrible malaria. We're not having ACT combinations. Now, the question is this. Once this ACT combination fails, where do we go to?
Okay.
Now, most of the time, people doing researches on malaria are not even having malaria endemicity. Okay, they don't have the malaria disease, and then they're just doing it to help sub-Saharan African who have burden of all diseases you can think of. Now, people now just take the drug. They don't understand that the dosing and timing is very critical because the dosing and timing of those drugs is in sync with the life cycle of the parasite in the human body.
Okay.
The dosing and timing is so important. The need that you must complete those treatments is so key if we need to honestly deal with the issue of malaria control.
Okay.
At malaria control, we have to deal with the issue of malaria control. So now, the people think they know so much, like Riley said. You know, before you know it, the chemist, they enter to the chemist, they buy drugs because those ones are driven not by quality of service but by the kind of profit they can make.
Okay.
You know, they buy, and then somebody comes, one of those, you know, interesting and worrisome advert is that you now see somebody who is used to cracking jokes will now come and say, hey, this is the drug you have to use for malaria. Honestly, if you look at it, it's not going to hit me deeply. You probably want to see a doctor, you know, like the medical officer of health in Ibadan now on TV. You want to see somebody like that dress up in, you know, medical dress, put on a stethoscope and push. Even if you want to do that, push for that drug. Why should I take, you know, why should I use somebody
a comedian
to advertise such a critical drug?
Sell the drug based on the popularity
and that's the danger in it. And so what we've gotten is that, you know,
so we're not promoting those drugs in
a professional
manner.
Quality way. So everybody just grab it. You know, this comedian said
it.
Everybody just grab it and use. Once they get a bit well, they abandon the rest of the dosing.
Yeah.
Of course, this drug comes with some side effects.
Okay.
You understand? When the patient said that, I'm just feeling weak because I'm using this drug. They don't want to endure for that 3 days. To complete their dose.
Okay.
They just abandon the drug and go, but they say, I'm feeling well, Jerry. Jesus is my health. You know, this is a critical problem we're facing. For me, we need to honestly look at how we present these things to the public.
Okay.
Because we have limited molecule to deal with. And we have to communicate it, especially at the local government level, you know, where my colleague belongs, and especially, you know, pushing it to the household dynamics in such a way that, you know, we understand that once you commence your drug, you know, you complete your drug. And in addition, we should find a way of discouraging, you know, every chemist, every patent medicine store
selling it over the counter.
You know, because It's a key disease, you understand? More than 60% of hospital attendance in this country is because of malaria.
But then again, the question again would be, since you just said that almost every chemist and local shops you find, even they even hawk anti-malaria drugs on the street, and they even combine it with all forms of multivitamins and all of that. So would you say that there should be a restrictions, control from the NMA or something, you know, restricting these people from selling malarial drugs over the counter?
We need to standardize the process of pushing this drug out. We need to standardize it, honestly, sincerely. Now, if, after Okosogwu, what's the name of that lady that was killed in Festa because they bought Rohypnol over the counter? You know, even a lot of chemists are not very careful to sell ordinary diazepam over the counter. That is kind of, we don't want to wait to that situation. Now, we want people to streamline, where's your prescription? Has the doctor done any test for you at that level, you understand? My colleague was mentioning about rapid tests, you know, for malaria. Have you done any test? Are you sure the doctor assented to this? It's not just for everybody to wake and say, okay, I have headache, my leg is paining me, go and take anti-malaria. We're losing the efficacy of the molecule. Once we lose the efficacy of the molecule, where do we go to?
Okay, doctor, then again, I don't know, because most times you hear people talk about genotypes and, you know, association with malaria. That is, that you're more susceptible if you have a particular genotype, and maybe specifically, say if you're AS, you're more prone to having malaria. How true is this?
No, you know, if you are AS, you may not actually have malaria. Okay. Somebody was saying on the Vox Pop that, you know, you really have malaria. You know, the genotype itself is a mutation, an adaptation to fight malaria, that genotype. So when you have, you know, a heterologous, I mean, we have A and S. The S protects you against malaria. But if you have A and A, you are prone. If you have S and S, you are prone.
Okay.
That is the understanding. Nobody is going to, because of that push for everybody to have ASG. Because, again, we've seen countries, you'll be shocked, ordinary countries have eliminated malaria.
Completely.
Eliminated. Zero. United Arab Emirates is one. Morocco, on top of Nigeria, is one. Even Eastern Bloc, like Kyrgyzstan and some of those tiny countries, Maldives is one. They've eliminate malaria.
How did they do it?
And even a country like Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka is a poor country.
Yes,
it has filed, for certification for elimination.
Wow.
No, sorry, for eradication of malaria. And then you wonder, you have in a country, Nigeria, with all this hype, the biggest economy in the deal, so on that, and then we cannot even sustainably control. I'm talking about level of control.
Yeah.
We cannot, honestly control malaria. You not to talk of, eliminating, because elimination means, you over a geographical area, you're able to limit transmission. You understand? You have to be able to limit transmission.
So the barest
at that point, you are looking at the vector. You understand?
Yes.
Through insecticide treated nets, either through, indoor residual spraying, either through, proper environmental, intervention that will prevent, vector transmission of the parasites.
Okay.
You understand? So even we've not been able to deal with control, elimination is a challenge to us. Why? Because some of this thing requires, proper communication, not just it requires proper communication, understanding, going to the dynamics of where this thing is more important, or is most important, And then, in addition, it requires human resources, requires funding, requires government commission and will. We had a lot of beautiful proposal on ground. WHO puts a proposal, it's cascaded down to the federal government, the federal presidential initiative on malaria comes down, it goes to the state, and then the local government. For me, I've read some of these things. Beautiful. Beautiful in the sense that it can be used to attract donors.
Okay.
You understand? That's how beautiful it is. But when it comes to, yes, it's good to attract money. It's good to attract donors and partners. But when it comes to the key thing that we ensure that we're able to sort out the health challenges at lower level, we're lackadaisical. And you can even imagine that recently Senate is trying to investigate how $500 million, given to National Primary Health Care Development Agency went into thin air, mismanaged. So again, you look at it, you wonder that, honestly, where are we going? It's nice for us to sit down, you know, I present paper and bring papers that, listen, we have a beautiful thing on ground. Mm. Yes, it will bring money from United Nations. Mm. It will bring money from Bills and Melinda Gates Foundation. But honestly, at my local place in Nigeria, it's not going to help anybody.
Mm. Okay.